group number two. Do we have group number two here? Yes, okay, good. For those who were not here yesterday, just a quick summary. Yesterday we were talking about the quality of chastity, what it actually means. Chastity equals tolerance plus shyness. We were getting into the whole deeper understanding of the importance of tolerance. Tolerance can only be cultivated with the two tools. What are the two tools to cultivate tolerance? Who remembers? Humility and
faith
in Krishna. Yes. And then we were talking about shyness. Shyness being what? What's the shyness? Yes, control L. Controlling the powerful feminine energy, keeping it tight so this energy doesn't burst out into the world and create havoc, as Prabhupada said. Right? Shyness basically being that we resist the temptation to enjoy the powerful effect of our feminine energy. That's what shyness means. So much more deep than what we usually use that word. And then we were talking about how to address a woman. Manaji, Padri, and. So we were talking about the importance of mother and spiritual culture, and there she is, the topmost personality in the day. And in materialistic culture, she is losing that valuable contribution of being first guru, creating the whole spiritual atmosphere in the home and thus within society. She's reduced as a cook and cleaner, and so that's why many women obviously don't like to be called mother, because it doesn't give any good. They don't have such good sense skills there in regards to motherhood. And we were concluding, actually, the father calls his 2-year-old daughter mother. Yes, just to help her to grow into this role of serving as mother. Not only physical mother, but also in spiritual sense, this nurturing, balancing, harmonizing energy, selfless service, mother being. What was the main thing what mother is? One main aspect? No lust, no sexual vibes, no showing off. Otherwise she's not mother, actually. Yes. Okay, so now let us have a look at our role file.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu, Mataji, Prabhu, Prabhi, Devi, Dasi, Avatar, Goswamini.
What they're speaking about?
I don't understand what to call you. How do you want to be addressed? How do you want me to refer to you?
Actually, Srila Prabhupada said that all women should be considered as mothers. And so we are all considered ourselves as mothers. Is that all right, Mayapur?
Oh, yes. Yes, I understand.
So, dear son, call me as mother, call me mother or Mataji.
Yes, Mataji, I will definitely do that. Actually, mother is the first and foremost Supreme Guru, so thank you very much for instructing me, Mataji. Now I understand.
Short and sweet and to the point. No need for anything in regards to mother. There's a couple more little things that came to my mind, which I thought I'd share in the beginning now. There was this Prabhupada disciple called Isha, Mother Isha. Anybody has heard of her?
Yes.
So she left her body a few years ago, and she was, you know, in Boston Temple. When Ranjana Swami, as a young bhakta, he joined there. And then, you know, just before she left, she had a stroke, and unfortunately she ended up in a nursing home. And Ranjana Swami once took all the time and effort to visit her there. So in any case, once I was talking to him about this Mother Isha, and he was saying one thing to me which really struck me actually. He said, Mother Isha is my mother in Krishna consciousness. I don't go anywhere without remembering her. Yes. And I thought that was pretty remarkable for a sannyasi, you know, to say such a thing. I hope he doesn't mind me sharing this here in front of the camera. But no, this once again just made this point to me how important mothers actually are. Even for brahmacharis, for young bhaktas, I once saw a picture of her transcribing Prabhupada's lectures, you know, famous picture. She must have been already around 50 plus when Ranjana Swami joined, you know. That's what she looks like on the photo there. Or maybe not 50, maybe 45 or something, I don't know. And, you know, she looks really motherly on that photo with a round face and very simple and, you know. So you can just imagine, you know, she might have been there, the mother in the temple, making sure the boys have their hot milk and this and that, you know. And, well, you know, what, saying what I shared yesterday, how this brahmachari was saying to me in Bangladesh, yes, mother more important than the Diksha Guru, more affection, you know. So I found that similar, you know, thing there in Ranjana Swami's comment. She is my mother in Krishna consciousness. I don't go anywhere without remembering her. Yeah. So once again, a little hard these days to apply this, like so many things we have been discussing, because the whole atmosphere is so surcharged with all kinds of lusty impressions. People are so, you know, traumatized by lusty experiences, you know, that not so easy to apply this, you know, being mother to men or boys. It very easily again, it ends up somewhere else, you know. But I really do have this experience in Bangladesh, because there people are not traumatized by these lusty experiences. There the boys have no other experience with women except mother. That's all they know. They don't know anything else. And the whole atmosphere is just so much more, you know, pure and sattvic, and because the women all really play their roles, you know, that they're, the whole atmosphere is so different. It is so much more surcharged with affection. You know, spiritual culture is actually a culture of affection and care. It's very sweet, very beautiful, you know. Like, even last year I was traveling with a bunch of boys there on Prabhupada Marathon. And because I have a diet, I cannot eat the temple prasadam there, the chili of the oil and so on. So one of the boys was cooking for me. And then one day he was saying to me, Mataji, when you get old, you please inform me. I will come and cook for you. This is our duty. You are our mother. So when you get old, please inform me. And he said it with such, you know, with such pure and sincere mood, you know. It was very sweet actually. And they mean it too. They would do that. They're not just saying it or something. They actually really feel like that. She's our mother. We have to take her and care of her in her old age. You know, so when you are old, you inform me. I thought that was pretty funny, you know, you inform me, I will come for you. Yeah, so, but that's the mood, you know, they're these boys, they're not traumatized with all these lusty impressions, you know. It's a completely different atmosphere, you know. When I arrived there, they all come running, paying obeisances. Oh, Mataji, we were missing you. We felt like orphans while you were away. You know, I mean, where else would a Brahmachari dare to say something? They're not kids. I mean, they're, you know, 25, 30-year-old boys, you know. Yes, they're not kids, you know. But because the whole atmosphere is so different, the whole spiritual culture is so much intact, they don't have any other idea and thought except mother, that's all, you know. But of course the woman also really has to behave like mother. Like, you know, sometime I was taking some ladies with me just to give them some experience of Bangladesh, and then they asked me, oh Mataji, maybe you better come alone, you know. So, because they could feel other ladies, you know, from other Western countries, they're not real mothers. There's some other energy, you know, vibrating there. And they actually asked me to come alone, you know, yeah. So that's the thing, you know, before we really can, you know, apply this of being real mother, we have to really make sure our mother and nothing else. The main thing is there's no lust, no, no, you know, showing off, no unwanted energies there. You know. Okay. Yes. So before we continue, do we have any other comments, questions about the topics yesterday? Any doubts, concerns, anything? Yes?
Just to wrap a bow on it, I mean, what you're saying is that we're expected to call in every lady, every person, every female in this country.
Yes.
It's incumbent upon them to actually behave as mother.
Well, that will help them.
Yeah.
That will help us women to actually act like mothers.
That is the responsibility, isn't it? Like, it's our responsibility to think of them as mother.
Yes.
It's equally responsible the mothers actually think of themselves as
of course, mother. Of course, of
it
course.
Seems like that understanding is very much lacking.
Completely, because everybody thinks of just physical mother. You know, some people get, some ladies get angry. They say, "Why well, I'm not your mother, or I'm not a baby machine," you know. You get all kinds of ridiculous responses because people just don't have that understanding what mother in spiritual culture means. You know, that it is the highest respect and it stands for affectionate respect. That's, they don't mean no, you know, they don't understand. It's all lost and forgotten. That's the problem. So that's why we have to educate, you know. I think the only way is systematic education, you know, that devotees understand and actually can make that transformation there and that paradigm shift, you know, because we're just so conditioned for all this materialistic propaganda, you know. Okay, anything else? Yes? Yes. Why? Well, I mean, who am I to speculate on this? I don't even dare to. I mean, I of course I have quite a few thoughts on this. I mean, see, I mentioned yesterday, you know, that we were discussing how a woman loses that valuable contribution, and therefore she often is neglected, disrespected, you know, not given any value and appreciation. And we can say in order to give her more respect. You know, this is in my eyes why sometimes women, you know, want to be called Prabhu, and maybe why Prabhupada called them Prabhu, to simply give them some respect. Because in the early days of ISKCON also, the women were really mistreated and looked down upon because the devotees were so immature. You know? They were always saying, oh, women are Maya and this and that, and oh, get out, and you know, so there was a lot of immaturity there, and obviously Prabhupada could see that. So, you know, in my humble, you know, understanding, calling women Prabhu is simply a feeble attempt to give her more respect. But a woman who knows spiritual culture, if she is called Prabhu, she would feel reduced to being only Prabhu. Because mother is always master, but she is so much more than master. You know, but that only a woman knows who has insights into spiritual culture. And I mean, obviously another thing is also, when Prabhupada came to America, that was the height of the women's liberation equality, you know, movement. America at that time was definitely not ready to accept spiritual culture. It still is hardly ready, you know. And I mean, Prabhupada did so many things in the beginning just to get things happening, you know. He gave 21-year-old boys sannyas, even though he must have very well known that many of them wouldn't be able to maintain, but just to get things going, he did so many things, you know. But interestingly, you will not find, or I could not find, a written statement that women should be called Prabhu. It's not in the Bhagavatam. You know? Yes. But yesterday we read so many quotes where he says, the culture is, no matter what age she is addressed as mother. You know, even from her own father. Prabhupada says it again and again in lectures. You know, but he doesn't say in lectures that a woman should be called Prabhu, you know? Or in the Bhagavatam. And the Bhagavatam is the law books for the next 10,000 years. You know?
Yeah. If we're preaching in the West, and we have to approach, you know, both genders, and one, of course, is not at all ready to hear mother or Mataji, and certainly has no idea what the Prabhu or Master means, then how do we address them? I understand that in our minds we can consider them mother or, you know, aspiring mother.
What do you mean, non-devotee ladies? Or
exactly. Someone you meet on the street, you will look.
Well, you don't call them Mataji, you know?
Obviously, yeah.
Definitely not.
Yeah. What is the best transitional way to interact with such a person?
Well, not transitional way, just call them how materialists call each other, you know? Because that's all they know. So, see, that's the point. Day of the materialist, day of the spiritualist. Broad spectrum in between. So if you meet a person who is completely in the day of the materialist, you have to adjust to that. You can't confront them with the day of the spiritualist, you know, because it's like day and night, you know.
So just play act as
if... Yeah, of course. Mrs., madam, whatever. I don't know what people call each other, you know. You know better.
More or less hate you.
Huh?
More or less it's just hate you.
Hey, you, whatever, you know, whatever. Or they ask for the name, and then every second word is, oh, Susan, yeah, Susan, there's Susan, oh, yeah, take a book, Susan. You know, gets a bit on your nerves, but that's the American way of doing things, you know.
Yeah. I was just going to say that a book distribution, I was going to say, sir,
I mean, even amongst devotees, you know, obviously if we know a lady gets really agitated, if we call her Mataji, I will not need to agitate people, then just call her Prabhu, yeah? If that's what she wants, and if she doesn't know, you know, the deeper secrets of spiritual culture yet, rather than agitating people and confronting them, no need. It doesn't get us anywhere. You know? No need. But no harm to try and educate people, those who are open for it, you know? Yes. Yeah, I mean, we always have to remember it's a transformation. Day of the Materialist has to become our night. It has to be done voluntarily. It cannot be imposed. It cannot be forced upon people. It can only be inspired. And that's where we often go wrong, that we try and make hard and fast rules, this is right, this is wrong, and it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. It's all about transformation. And we can only inspire. And in order to transform, we have to be open. You know, we have to be open to new concepts and ideas and thoughts, otherwise we can't transform. If we are blocked and closed, no transformation can happen, so there's no use to, you know, harass people or something. Okay, so I think you all by now have the materials in front of you. So today, on the concluding session here, we have a few so-called controversial issues here. Topic number one, are women less intelligent? Right? Okay, so let us remember, you know, the soul is covered by the gross body of earth, water, fire, air, ether, and subtle body of mind, intelligence, here it is, and false ego. So what is this intelligence? It is simply, you know, an element of the subtle material body. That's all. Nothing else. And as we were saying, male body, female body, gross and subtle are very, very different. So that they can play certain roles and functions. Right? So I always make this joke, men also as a rule, have bigger feet, right? But nobody gets agitated about that, you know, oh, it's only the feet. We don't identify so much with the feet, but when it comes to intelligence, we identify so much with it, and that's why we get all agitated. Especially in materialistic culture, as we said, subtle body is really emphasized. It is really blown up. People are feeding and expanding the subtle body of intelligence and false ego. People are so proud of, oh, my intelligence, my degrees, and. So much emphasis is given to intelligence. So that's why people get very disturbed and agitated when they hear women are less intelligent, because it's just bodily platform. That's all it is. Yes, because we are identifying with the intelligence and we are so proud of it. And then when we hear that we have less than the men, we get all agitated. But as I said, men also have broader shoulders, stronger muscles, bigger feet. And then we don't get agitated. That's all right, no problem. But intelligence, you know, yes. Yeah, so it's simply a subtle element of the subtle material body, that's all it is. And subtle body, in order to go back to God, it has to be dissolved. So it's an advantage if it's a little smaller, less work to dissolve. Yes. And especially intelligence can really be an obstacle, because very easily we become so proud. Oh, I'm this, I'm that, I'm a PhD, I'm this, that. Oh, you know, yes. Even, I mean, we know there's this purport where Prabhupada says, first canto, I think, right, that the four principles of material advancement, high education, high family, good wealth, and bodily beauty are, so to speak, disqualifications in progress of material life, spiritual life. So education is in there. And I dare say, even spiritual higher education can also really feed one's pride and become an obstacle. I've seen it. Yes. Yes. I think in the Holy Name Retreat we were mentioning how, you know, humility is the digestive medicine to digest our opulences and talents. And if our opulences and talents are not digested with humility, they become toxic. Like food not being digested becomes toxic for the body. Same in a subtle way, you know, if our opulences and talents are not digested with humility, they become poisonous. Yes. And higher education is one of them, definitely. Even sometimes also in spiritual life, you know, if our, you know, Bhakti Vaibhava, Bhakti Vedanta degrees are not digested with humility, it can poison our whole spiritual life. You know? So very often this higher intelligence can be an obstacle because we become proud. You know? Yes, unfortunately. Yes. And of course, we mentioned it in the first session. Let's see if anybody remembers, some of you were not there. If a man puts a woman down for being less intelligent, what does that mean? Just to be clear. Don't shout out. Huh?
He's on the bodily
platform. He is on the bodily platform, yes. Yes. You know? He identifies with the intelligence just as much as the woman who gets agitated. He doesn't see through the external body, he doesn't see on the level of the soul, there's equality there. Right? So if he is in a discriminating and disrespectful way acting towards women, saying, oh, they're less intelligent, oh, you know, it means bodily platform. Yeah. So let's get off the bodily platform and try and see, you know, through the externals there and see everybody has built soul and recognize that equality there. Yes. Okay. Does that fit, does it? Yes. Okay. Your legs are too short. So we have here Prabhupada in a Srimad Bhagavatam lecture on the 3rd of August 1968. I was student of psychology in my college life. Dr. Urquhart said, I remember still, that the brain substance has been found up to 64 hours, while brain substance of woman has been found highest 34 hours. Therefore, woman class, Prabhupada laughs, is not so intelligent as men. There is no question of competition. It is actual scientific fact. But one thing I must explain here, so far spiritual life is concerned, it does not depend on the material brain substance. It is a different thing. It is spiritual platform. It has nothing to do with this bodily construction. You must remember, we don't make any distinction that a man can be better Krishna consciousness than woman. No, a woman can be better Krishna consciousness because they are very simple. They can accept any religious system. Generally, the women, they accept it because they are very simple. They have no crooked mind. Sometimes they are exploited, therefore. So in the spiritual platform, there is no such distinction. Although in the material Just like the bodily construction of man is different from woman, similarly the brain substance may also be different. But that does not disqualify any woman for spiritual advancement in Krishna consciousness. So, very clear. Prabhupada makes the same point here, you know. Has nothing to do with spiritual qualification. Nothing. Nothing. Also, I remember hearing it once from Bhaktivedya Purnaswami. There is some differences also, you know, that, for example, men, once they're caught on the central platform, they can't really so easily withdraw. In other words, once a man is attached to a woman, he can't pull back and say, hang on, what am I doing here? I'm married, I've got 3 kids, you know, I'm the president here or something. This is all nonsense, forget it. You know? No. Once he is hooked, you know, he can't so easily have his rational function coming in and letting go of this. Whereas a woman can, yes. Huh? No, no. From what I've heard, it's not. And there's many examples also in the history where men ruined their whole career and everything just because of some love affair with a woman. You know? But women, and I guess this is because they play that important role of being mother, you know? If a woman is caught there on the central platform, she can more easily pull back and say, no, forget it, this is nonsense. I've got a family here, and I'm not going to sacrifice that just for some affair or something. Yes. Yeah, no, I've heard it from several sides. Yes.
I just wanted to add that my Guru Maharaj says that woman senses and intelligence works at the same time, like that he's showing it. And at men's psychology, it works either intelligence or senses. That's why when he's switching on in senses,
Okay. Yeah, I remember also some more details there with the brain parts and this and that, and I forgot the details. But yes, I mean, that would be a good way to describe it, you know, that women's senses and intelligence work parallel. And I guess she needs that for her function of being a mother. Women are also very good at multitasking. Right? Women can do so many things at once. They have to, you know, to be a mother and run a household and cook and change the nappies and this and that. You have to be multitasking, you know, but a man usually concentrates on one thing and he just can only do one thing. Yes, oh, I've observed it a lot of times, you know, when I want to multitask, then the men say, just let's do that first and after that, you know, we think of the next thing, you know. So, yeah, and again, you know, for a man, if he wants to, you know, protect, fight the tiger, you know, his intelligence has to be focused. He can't just multitask, you know, do other things there also, you know. So again, nice to see how really the exactly the right qualities and natures are built in to the male and female vehicle, just so they can play their roles perfectly. It's a whole perfect system there, which Krishna has given, you know, to create stability and harmony in this world. Yeah. So now one thing, of course, why a woman is also considered less intelligent is because woman's body means, or having a woman's body means stronger bodily identification, you know? And again, has to be like that, because otherwise she will not feel inspired to make herself all pretty and beautiful and decorate and bring the color and beauty into life. You know, if she was as detached as a man, then she would not play that function, you know? So just to make sure, she's adding that color and beauty into life, you know, she has to be more on the bodily platform, otherwise how will she play the role? So, and also, another reason why women are considered less intelligent is because of the emotional nature, which very easily clouds the vision. And again, same thing. It's built into the female vehicle so that she can be a good mother. We mentioned already before on the first day, you know? If she didn't have that emotional nature, she would forget that she has a child, you know? Yes, she would not have that caring propensity, you know, because a child is helplessly dependent on the care and affection of the mother. So she needs that more emotional nature, otherwise she's not going to be able to play the role. Also, women have more intuition. And again, she needs that to know what the child needs. Men don't have that, you know? When the baby cries, men don't know anything what to do with the baby, you know? But a mother knows, she's got that intuition. My child is sick, my child wants to sleep, my child wants to eat. She knows, you know? She's got that intuitive connection there with the child. Absolutely necessary in order to be a good mother and caregiver there in the family, right? So now the emotional nature is what easily gets in our way, because the emotions cloud our vision, and then very easily we overreact, you know, we misjudge situations, we panic, this, that, and that's also one reason why we women need that protection of a man. So that, you know, the man says, don't worry, cool down, just relax, we'll sort it all out, just sleep over, tomorrow everything will be fine, and so he's got that rational vision of things, you know, which help her to cool down, you know. So, and we have here this nice purport where Prabhupada very strongly speaks about this, you know. And this is in the story with Parvati and Lord Shiva, where Parvati sits on Shiva's lap, Chitraketu coming past, you know. Long ago we were discussing it in the Bhagavatam class. And, you know, Chitraketu makes some joking remark there about Lord Shiva sitting like that in the assembly of sages and saints. And Lord Shiva just was smiling. He knew he was just, you know, joking, basically. But Parvati got very agitated. She took it very seriously because of her emotional attachment to her husband. She got all, you know, upset. And she chastised him. Who do you think you are? You know, my husband is the spiritual master of the universe, and how do you dare to talk like this? And you are just puffed up because you are a devotee of Lord Vishnu, and that's why you think you can talk like this. So, and she curses Chitraketu to take birth as a demon. So, and then in this one purport, Prabhupada speaks very clearly, you know. He says, here's the difference between male and female that exists even in the higher statuses of life. In fact, even between Lord Shiva and his wife. Lord Shiva could understand Chitraketu very nicely, but Parvati could not. Thus, even in the higher statuses of life, there is a difference between the understanding of a male and that of a female. It may be clearly said that the understanding of a woman is always inferior to the understanding of a man. In the Western countries, Prabhupada knows exactly what's going on, there is now agitation to the effect that man and woman should be considered equal, but from this verse it appears that woman is always less intelligent than man. Ooh, this is hard for many women to swallow. It took me also many years to understand this more deeply. It is clear that Chitraketu wanted to criticize the behavior of his friend Lord Shiva, because Lord Shiva was sitting with his wife on his lap. Then too, Lord Shiva wanted to criticize Chitraketu for externally posing as a great devotee, but being interested in enjoying with the Vidyadhara women. These were all friendly jokes. There was nothing serious for which Chitraketu should have been cursed by Parvati. Upon hearing the instructions of Lord Shiva, Parvati must have been very much ashamed for cursing Chitraketu to become a demon. Mother Parvati could not appreciate Chitraketu's position, and therefore she cursed him. But when she understood the instruction of Lord Shiva, she was ashamed. In fact, it is described that she was covering her face with her sari headpiece, you know, thinking, oh my God, what a fool, you know, I was, you know, overreacting here, really, you know, really overreacted. So, and this comes because of the emotional nature. That's all. Right? Yes. So now the way I understand Prabhupada saying, you know, the view of a man is always, or the of a woman is always inferior to understanding of a man. Not any woman's, you know, view is superior to, inferior to any man's, obviously. But if a man and a woman are of equal caliber, like Shiva and Parvati, you know, they're not ordinary men, not ordinary women. They're compatible. They're of equal equal caliber. And then men's view is always superior to woman's view. Yes. Not any man's view is superior to any woman's view, obviously. Right? Or you think I'm speculating too much here?
Yeah.
It makes sense, doesn't it? Yes. I mean, for many years I was puzzled. I was thinking, God, any man, you know, how is that going to work? Just, you know, any devotee woman that has inferior vision to any non-devotee man or something? No, obviously not, you know. So they have to be of similar caliber and advancement and sincerity and. But even if they are of similar caliber, still, because of that emotional nature, woman's view is always inferior to man. Yes. So we better accept it. Well, it just comes with the vehicle. No big deal. Doesn't mean that we are disqualified from devotional life or from going back to Godhead or something. No, not at all. In fact, let us think of some examples from the Shastra, which clearly shows actually that woman's nature, woman's body is actually an advantage. Who can think of some famous examples? Yes? Yes, the wife of the Brahmanas. When Krishna and Balaram were hungry, you know, the Brahmanas, they were all absorbed in their puja. They are, no, sorry, we're too busy, we don't have time. But the wives, they were ready to drop anything, of course. Krishna and Balaram want something to eat, of course. You know? Yes. Or another one, what else is there? Yes, wives of Kaliya. What else?
Wife of Shiva.
Yes.
Parvati. When she was offended by Daksha. What's her name?
Yes. Sati. Yes.
Also.
But how?
Well, she attained perfection because she followed her husband to the end and didn't let it to be offended. She was so
yeah,
chastened.
All right. Okay.
A man couldn't do that. Sorry.
Okay. One of my favorite examples is also when Krishna has a headache and wants the dust of his devotees. You know, the men all refuse. No, this will get us to hell. How can we give our dust, you know, to Krishna? But the gopis, no problem. If that cures Krishna's headache, you can have tons of it. Or just the gopis in themselves is already, you know, approved, you know. Yeah, I mean, there's so many examples, you know. I remember when I was married, I used to have this discussion with my husband, what's a better deal, the woman's body or the man's body, you know? And he was convinced woman's body, better deal, you know? Because actually, to a large degree, for us women, it is more natural to develop the service moves, you know, and to follow. Because as mother, as wife, we have to cultivate it if we want to be happy as mother and wife, you know. So it is in many ways more natural, and Prabhupada says it too, you know, that actually for women much easier to accept any religious system and follow it and that, you know. Yeah, maybe let's do a quick little exercise here. We can have the ladies sharing an example with their partner, with their neighbor, a situation from daily life where our emotions got in our way and we overreacted. Just for a bit of self-assessment here, right? And maybe for the men, they can share an experience where they had a woman overreacting and they had to, you know, maybe play the one who says, just cool down and relax, we'll work it all out. Maybe some men don't haven't had that experience. Yeah, otherwise I'm not sure what else could they share.
When they lose their
temper.
Oh, we lose our temper sometimes.
Yeah, but that's not to the topic here, you know, of the emotional nature clouding our vision. Anyway, let the ladies share anyway, just to, you know, assess ourselves here. Share with your neighbor for a few minutes an example from your personal life where your emotions got in your way and you overreacted, you misjudged, you were jumping to conclusions. I mean, I'm sure the men know these examples too. I mean, in temple life, you know, we come across it all the time where women overreact and react emotional, right? Oh, I think so. Yes, I mean, yes. So, share something, come on.
You see
me? No, I have to think about it.
My wife is so good.
To throw things in the trash, but
across the room into the trash can. I wasn't so
building up inside of her, like she was becoming very angry that I was throwing the markers and then one time she just exploded and was like, "You have no restriction, you're just throwing the markers." I was totally shocked, but I never threw the markers before, so it was, I guess. But I realized if she just told me from the beginning, then I would have known, oh.
about this, and then Prabhupada gives this So I'm striking it in. So yes, they are, as long as they think they are women. Meaning, as long as they think, you know, identify with the body, less intelligent anyway. You know. All right. So, do we have any more questions about this topic of women being less intelligent, emotional nature, bodily platform, and any questions, comments about that?
One thing, Bhakti Vidyapurna Swami said 2 weeks ago. I don't. Have you been in this lecture? He said something about it, about the intelligence of the Shastra.
No, actually, I think it was just before I came, and I missed the class. I think it was even that verse, wasn't it? Anybody was there?
I was there.
Yes, because when I arrived in Mayapur, I saw, oh my God, that's that part of the Bhagavatam. And I quickly had a look, and then I saw it was his turn to give class on that exact report. But I wasn't there. What did he say?
He said something like, I hope I remember correctly, he said that intelligent by the Shastra is only referred to the way we are explaining Shastra or trying to realize Shastra.
Hang on, what?
Realize.
I think it was the three ways to learn. By hearing, realizing automatically, by seeing and then realizing, and then the third is experiencing to realize. And I think he was saying that the women most always realize by experience. Whereas men,
he says the following: the Shastra intelligent means only knowledge about spiritual subject and how to distinguish between matter and spirit. Since women are more on intuition level and emotional level, they are more sensing than trying to understand philosophically before they do something. This is what he said. They have less capabilities in respect. Though he said, though in Kali Yuga we are all Shudras, and sometimes the man's capabilities to understand in reasonable way before doing can become a disadvantage. That's what he said.
Well, I mean, what we are talking about here is material intelligence, not spiritual intelligence. You know? It's material intelligence. So just a woman being less intelligent doesn't mean she has less realization or something, or spiritual intelligence. Doesn't mean that at all. You know, an illiterate village woman, she might not have any much material intelligence, no higher education, nothing, but she might have so much spiritual intelligence, understanding, yes, of course Krishna is God, and of course everything is, you know, meant for his pleasure. Of course, what else? Of course everything comes from him. Of course. But then a very highly educated professor at the university who has so much material intelligence, he might have zero spiritual intelligence because he can't see anything in connection with Krishna. You know? I mean, ultimately, realization is awarded by Krishna from within the heart. So, Vasya Chaturvedi Sanavisto. So, that has nothing to do with intelligence. Material intelligence is often in the way. That's the point. It is often in the way because it leads to pride and then analyzing. Actually, just the other day, where was it? I was giving somewhere a seminar, and one person gave this funny example. You know, the simple village person steps into some stool. So his foot is full of stool. So what does he do? He just goes it, you know, wipes it off in the grass and holds it under the water there. But then the intelligent city person, he has to work out, what is it? What is there on my foot? So he takes, you know, the hand, smells it, puts it, dabs it on the nose. So he's got the stool on three parts of the body, the the head, the nose, you know. Trying to find out what kind of stool did I step into. I have to analyze this here, you know. But you know, the simple village person, no need to find out. He understands it's something not so good there on my foot, and he just gets rid of it, you know. So that's just a funny example of how...
That's a great example.
Yeah, it really is. You know, especially you can relate to it in India, where there's everywhere some stool heaps, you know, and easily you can step into something. Yeah, so, you know, the material intelligence, yes, can often be in the way, you know.
Yeah, I think maybe we can sort of visualize intelligence as like a wall. So the higher the wall, the more difficult it is for things to even get in. And I can say as a man, sometimes we have to overanalyze things so much, we never even get to the root of the issue.
Never get?
To the root of whatever issue we have.
Yeah, and often it really bypasses the heart level, you know? I've noticed that a lot, even in the Holy Name retreats when we talk about, you know, involving the heart. Sometimes men say to me, what does it mean? So disconnected from the heart level, only in the head, just the mind and intelligence. And the heart level, disconnected, you know. But for a woman, much easier to connect with the heart level, you know.
Sometimes it's an advantage because it keeps us from doing stupid things. But other times, it prevents us from doing things that would really help. We second guess, we're so full of doubt all the time. So there's so many doubts, we can't really make it.
So, it's just the tractor and the sports car, you know. So both have their purposes, their natures, their qualities, their good use, you know, their advantages, disadvantages. We simply have to learn to use whatever we got and the right purpose. And if we do that with a Krishna consciousness, it leads to purification. Perfect. No need to argue what's the better deal or something, you know? Okay. Shall we move on? You don't need a break yet, do you? No, 4:15. Let's start at least the next topic, yeah? Okay. So, another hot issue. Can women lead kirtan or give class? Coming from a woman speaking, yeah? So, let us look a little bit at culture background and what Bhaktivinoda Thakur has to say about this. He gives a very nice guideline here. He says, women who are pure devotees can become traveling women salesmen for distributing the holy name amongst other women, but they cannot give the name to men. According to time, place, and circumstances, however, and with great care, a cautious and mature woman can distribute the name to men. Apart from elderly women or very young girls, men preachers should avoid discussions with other women. So discussions with other women, according to my understanding, means private discussions, you know? So actually male preachers, alright, with elderly women or very young girls, okay, no problem, but with the age group in between there, should actually avoid private discussions, because as we know, in the name of preaching, so often, so many other things are going on, you know? Yes, that's simply a rule of etiquette there. But now, let us have a look here. What Bhaktivinoda Thakur is saying. So obviously traveling women salesmen distributing the holy name, to my understanding it means kirtan as well as class, preaching. Traveling women salesmen is traveling creature, right? So basically, you know, the basic etiquette and guideline is women should give the holy name to women. But then, according to time, place and circumstance, however, with great care, a cautious and mature woman, who is, by the way, also a pure devotee, of course, can also give the holy name to men. So, I mean, that already, you know, gives quite a bit of a guideline here, how, at least how things are in spiritual culture. Let's put it that way. As we are always saying, we are not establishing here what women should do and not do or something, but simply get insights, how are things in spiritual culture. And I mean, you see it in Vrindavan, you know, often the ladies get together, they have their bhajan groups there, and, you know, yeah. So, that should be kind of, we don't want to make rules here, but it is a good guideline that actually women should, could practice, that's how it is in spiritual culture, they practice with preaching amongst women. After all, more than half of the community is usually women. More than half. Yes. So why insisting that it has to be in front of men or something? Why not just preach to women, get practice, qualify ourselves, become more mature, you know, which also means age-wise also. Age-wise, yeah, in regards to age, you know, that's...
How old is she?
Yeah, how old is she, you know, naturally, you know, if there's a young, pretty girl dressed up in silk sari and earrings and bangles, you know, preaching to men, well, they're probably going to be more preoccupied there looking at her body, you know, rather than hearing what she's got to say, you know. And actually, interesting, once when I gave that seminar in Bangalore, one Mataji said, well, it would take me also some time to settle down. You know, if a young, beautiful girl would give a class, I would also check her out and look at her earrings and the sari and is it all matching? And so it would also take me some time to actually settle down and really hear from her. Because as we were saying before, often amongst the women is that competition there, you know, that we look, oh, how is she dressing up and this and that. So, can be distracting not only for the men, but even for the women. Wow. It's all subtle, but it's there, you know, it's there. And I mean, not wanting to take me as an example, but simply unconsciously, I was actually following exactly that. While I was married for 10 years, my husband being temple president, I never sat on the Vyasa Sangha, never. Even though I was quite involved there, you know, in this temple we had in Latvia with 75 brahmacharis, 30 brahmacharinis, I was the mother of the whole establishment there. And I remember some of the men were saying, oh, why is the Devaki Mataji not giving class? But I somehow felt, no, not proper, you know. But I was every single week having a women's program, every week for 10 years. Yes. So, and then only when my husband left Krishna consciousness, I was going into white, then I thought, all right, now it's time to give a Bhagavatam class, you know. Yes. So intuitively, nobody instructed me like this, but intuitively I feel I kind of actually applied this, you know, simply qualifying myself more first with the women, not wanting to show off there and impress the men and this and that. All these things are there, you know, as a younger devotee. And also remembering the power of the feminine energy. You know, so obviously, if a woman shows off, so much more contaminating to the atmosphere than when a man shows up. It really is. Yeah? Or if a woman, you know, behaves badly, starts screaming or whatever, much more contaminating to the whole atmosphere than when a man screams. Then we can tolerate, let him scream. You know, but a woman screaming, you know, this is really bad, you know? Yes, yes. And that comes because the feminine energy is so much more powerful. More powerful. So same thing when a woman shows off there from the Vyasa Sun or something. More poisonous to the atmosphere than when a man shows off. You know, now being at the end of the whole course, let us collect a few more thoughts, what effect it might have on men when a woman gives class. She's not so mature and cautious, and she's maybe, you know, more dressed up and this and that, you know. What effect could it have on the men? Remembering the whole discussion of the week. Yes. Distraction. Well, we kind of mentioned that already, you know, that he will be more looking at her beauty and this and that, especially also because men get agitated through the eyes, you know, so he will be more distracted. But what else? What else? We were talking about so many other things. Huh? Well, that comes along with distraction, comes sense gratification. But no, what else? What else?
Competition, and he will go down.
Yes, well, because unfortunately this comes very easily in any way, that, you know, that we women do compete, we discussed that, you know, because of this whole misunderstanding of equality, that's why the competition is invited in. So if a woman gives class in a competitive mood, you know, it's a very subtle thing. Subtle thing, it's an ego matter. If she wants to prove you, oh, we women can do it too, you know, look at me, how smart I am and how many verses I can quote here and. Well, what effect will it have to a man? Huh? What effect? Huh?
Discouraging.
Yeah, discouraging. You know, he's not that such a woman will not agree to be the auspicious source of energy and inspiration to the men. She's using her energy for herself. And this will weaken the man. It might even make him insecure, you know, because as we were saying, for a man's heart, the most painful thing is to be a loser and a fool in the eyes of a woman. So if a man sees, oh, she can do it much better, very easily it can discourage him, and he's afraid of this painful experience there, that he looks like a fool or something, and then he might not even want to give class so easily, or she knows it all better anyway. And yeah, and he will... He will easily become weaker, actually. Yes. Yes. What else?
It also reduces her position from mother to Prabhu. In his eyes, reduces her position of respect from mother to Prabhu.
Hang on, what?
In his eyes, the man who's watching the class reduces his respect for her from going as respecting as a mother, reducing the respect as Prabhu, which is not as high.
Well, I dare say it's the other way around. That if he actually sees a woman as mother, then he will not really have such a problem to hear from her, because it is also mother's position.
I was thinking about when you were saying she's screaming on the Vyasa Sun.
No, not screaming from the Vyasa Sun. I meant if a woman, not from the Vyasa Sun, just loses her temper and screams at somebody, you know, in the daily temple affairs. Yes, not from the Vyasa. That was not what I meant.
You also said the woman who is giving class is not mature, is not is too younger, distracting, pretty, like that.
Yes.
So, for that, instead of seeing her as mother, which at least by reading the books, you can get an understanding, a surface understanding that she should be considered mother. Instead, if she's giving class and is distracting, then it takes away his ability to respect her as mother.
Yeah? How do you feel about that? Can you relate to that? For me, not so easy, to be honest. Because, if a man really sees a woman as mother and nothing else,
that takes training, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. And I think, for example, in Bangladesh there's no problem with women giving class.
Because they're getting that training from birth.
Yes, yes. But also, I have to be honest, I haven't seen any other women giving class there, except my humble self. But I've never come across any objections there, because they see me as mother and I'm a little elderly. Most of them could be my children. So there's never been any objection or anything. Nothing. So I dare say, if a man has that training and that vision of seeing a woman as mother, then that will help him more easily to also hear from her. But if he doesn't see her as mother, then he will see her more likely as competition.
But also, as you were saying earlier, for him to see her as mother, there's also some responsibility on the lady's part to act as mother.
Exactly.
And think of herself as mother.
Yes. Yes.
So if she doesn't, if she thinks of herself as teacher or instructor or guru or manager, then that position in the man's eyes goes down.
Oh, now I get you. Okay.
Maybe disrespectful as a sentence.
Not too loud. Yeah, could be. Yes, now I understand what you mean. Yes. Yes, any other thoughts? Why it might be not so easy for a man to hear from a woman? Yes.
I felt somewhere that the source of inspiration for a man, it must be only his wife, and maybe also mother or support, yes. And if he is inspired by some other woman, then it is actually not very honest towards his wife. But if, for example, a person hears to class by some woman and he is inspired by her, then he can begin to accept her as a wife in some way.
Attachment.
Some attachment, yes. If he is inspired.
Don't know. That only comes in, if he is distracted by her beauty, this, that. If there's some spiritual, if it is spiritual inspiration,
then he sees her as a mother. But if he sees her as a mother, then there's no problem. Because he might have many mothers.
Yes. Yeah, because I can't quite agree with that he should only, see his wife as inspiration. Krishna has given us, as we discussed yesterday, 5 human mothers. So they can be of inspiration or something. Why not? Then we are talking about some other inspiration here. it's some other inspiration, not transcendental inspiration. So, but also as a preacher, we have to be able to burn up whatever little material elements come along there, even when we accept service or when we give guidance or something, we have to be able to burn that up, actually. You know? Right? Yes, because whenever somebody offers service or something, there's always some material elements are there. So if we're not spiritually strong enough to burn them up, then we will get affected. You know? That's there in any case. You know, also for me and the same, you know. Can be the same the other way around, that if a man gives inspiration and the women get inspired, also sometimes the wrong way there, you know. So that the main preacher, he has to be spiritually strong enough to burn that up. Otherwise he gets entangled and affected. Yeah. Yes.
But that's the thing, according to how advanced the hearer is, sometimes instead of getting spiritual inspiration, you may just be getting innocent intellectual inspiration, which is still not on the spiritual platform. It seems innocent at first, but it can degrade and become a type of material attachment just because he's being intellectually and as you said, the same thing can go the other way, that the man can intellectually inspire a woman and it doesn't reach the spiritual platform, at least for the hearer.
But when the speaker is spiritually strong enough, it will not go further than that.
Most of the time. Depends on the hearer. Sometimes the hearer can be very immature.
Yes.
I also think that in this age when the mothers are not really mothers, and so it creates a lot of problem for the men to accept nicely, to be in the right mood.
Yeah, that's the main thing. Actually, I'm mentioning this here a little later, you know, that to sit on the Vyasa-san is not just a piece of furniture, you know. You're actually meant to represent Vyasadeva. So a certain maturity and also a certain level of being off the bodily platform actually has to be there. Yes, has to be there. For both men and women. I know one preacher in Europe, a man, he's dyeing his hair. You know? Some streaks there. And he sits on the Vyasa side and talks about the bodily platform of life. I mean, I'm sorry, I can't really take such a preacher so seriously. I don't really want to hear from him. Huh? You don't understand? I know a male preacher who is colouring his hair.
Colouring.
Dyeing his hair. You know? Dyeing with Y, not with IE. You know?
Even with, I don't know what's dyeing, but colouring at least.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and I think this is actually inappropriate that such a person should sit on the Vyasa side. Come on, you know? This is. How can you talk about the bodily platform of life if, as a man, you're colouring your hair? Yeah, isn't it? Or maybe, I don't know, maybe I'm fanatic or something. But, you know, and similar. So why I'm mentioning this is that there has to be a certain standard for both genders. It's not that it's only for the women, it's also for the men. You know, so in men by nature, are less on the bodily platform that comes along with a tractor, you know. So, and for women, it means that they have to be a little more mature, you know. I mean, I remember once in Bangladesh, I was telling the devotees there that in other countries, women are sitting on the Vyasa sun with silk saris and this and that, and they cracked up laughing, you know, yeah, and they couldn't believe it. It was unimaginable for them.
They thought you were joking.
Yeah, they didn't believe, you know, So, yeah, a certain level of maturity and being off the bodily platform has to be there, I think. At least, that's how it is in spiritual culture, let's put it that way. You know, that understanding is there in spiritual culture. And depending on how close we are there, how much we have transformed towards the day of the spiritualist, you know, then it will be for us very clear and acceptable. But if we're still over here, more in the day of the materialist, then it might sound like discrimination against women or something. You know? Right? Yes. Very true. Yes, yes. I wanted to mention the same thing when we come to the last thing there of woman being guru. I'm not sure she did. She never sat on the Vyasa-san. I thought what I had heard is that she had the curtain there always, you know, right? That she was behind a veil or curtain there. But I'm not sure whether she spoke from the Vyasa-san or from some other seat or something, that I don't know.
I heard that she was privately instructing disciples, but not having a formal position of a leader from the formality of figure,
yes.
which would be for men.
Yes. Although, what I have heard is that she did give public speeches, but not with open, you know, face there, but from a curtain. That's what but I am not so knowledgeable what exactly she did and not did. I don't know, simply what I've heard and picked up here and there, you know. But it's very true, she always stuck to her role of being the mother, cooking for the festival there, being in charge of that, and you know, but she was never competing with a man and trying to be in the front there. Definitely not. Yes, very true. Very true. Yes. I mean, let's maybe quickly play the whole example through. Oh, let's first, or shall we have a break? You want to have a break? Okay, let's take a 10-minute break and then we continue by reading here Prabhupada's letter and talking about the Indian towns. One little thing, hang on, before we go to the break.